Now, the proteolytic enzymes really began in the 1900s, around the turn of the 19th century. And a guy named Dr. Wolf, began using them, particularly pancreatic proteolytic enzymes, to treat cancer. And the theory is very simple. Cancer is a protein. Proteolytic enzymes will dissolve cancer. And to a certain extent, that's been true. Now, there are doctors in the U.S., like Dr. Nick Gonzalez in New York City, who really specializes in the use of these proteolytic enzymes to treat specific cancers that it particularly works well on. Pancreas is one of them.
With
good success, yeah. Well, when you understand cancer of the pancreas is almost always fatal, and I don't know exactly his success rates, but they're, maybe 30% or 40%. That's a whole lot better than 0 or 5% or 2%. So we always say relative when we say it. It's not 100%. I don't know his exact, but he's getting his success. So he's using a variety of the more sophisticated. In that case, they were using, animal active pancreas proteolytic enzymes. But that was 1900. It seems to help in other things too, other cancers. Later, they began to notice that it helped in other ways. And I'm more concerned about the other ways. My focus is not in the treatment of cancer, as you well know. So we kind of have to look at what do the proteolytic enzymes do? Well, first, they are secreted by the body. The body does make proteolytic enzymes. And I first got interested because of fasting. I had this just interesting idea. The body is shifting all its enzyme power inside to dissolve toxins and scarring and whatever, adhesions. What happens is, that's great. So why don't we copy it? So that's how I kind of discovered these things. And they're, again, initially it was a German product called Wobenzyme, which is an animal-based. I said, well, I can't use that. Oh, wait. So eventually, they came out with a vegan form of it, which is a different enzyme. Okay? But it's very super, it's equal to Wobenzyme. That's what it was designed to be. And so I'm using it, and as people got more sophisticated, we see that, yes, it's good for cancer, but it's good for all inflammation. Because the proteolytic enzymes are really what counters inflammation. Inflammation is, you got a wound, then, all these things are going into that area, things are leaking out of the area, and you have this kind of junk protein buildup, and the proteolytic enzymes dissolve that. So what we're finding in studies with athletes is it will cut down your healing time by 50%. Also, people have wisdom tooth. This is an example. You know how your jaw swells up with wisdom teeth? Again, the swelling and healing time is 50%. So it's not like a magic wand, but 50% is a lot when you got your jaw swollen up like that. If you're a professional athlete, 50% is a big deal when you're talking about a day or two recovery time that you have to have, and this maybe cuts it down to one day instead of 2 days, and you're actually being out to practice. It is good for sprained ankles, any kind of trauma, any kind of swelling, because swelling is an excess of protein going into the tissues. It will dissolve that. Okay, that's one level. It also has a regulatory part, so it's very good for all the autoimmune diseases. It may take longer. For rheumatoid arthritis, which is really pretty hard to heal, it may take 6 months before it starts to have an effect for rheumatoid arthritis or for immune. It seems to regulate. That's different than stimulate. Regulate means it brings it into balance. So that's another piece of what it does. It's inflammation. Now, the other thing that I wouldn't say I discovered, but in terms of diabetes, which is the other area I was actually using it in, what we found in the healing of type 1 diabetes, as well as primary, is that in type 1, you tend to have a lot of atherosclerosis and a lot of amputations. The arteries are clogged up from the atherosclerosis. It makes it go away. In other words, people scheduled for amputations don't get amputated. People who can't use their, you know, leg, after a while, their circulation increases to the leg. So it's a primary one for cleaning the arteries of atherosclerosis from its enzymatic function. It also has some anticoagulant effect. Now that's a downside. Because if your blood is thin or you are taking anticoagulants such as warfarin, coumadin, you know those names, heparin, you can't take this because it makes your blood too thin and you can bleed out. Does everybody understand that?
Yes.
You cannot give it to anyone with any blood thinners. Yeah. All the blood thinners, if you have that, you can't. Now, there's another side to the story, which is you can, this is not what you can do, but you know, the medical doctor who can work with them can slowly take them off that and put them on proteolytic enzymes. Much safer, still get the blood thinning, a different mechanism, you can't measure it, which is the problem. But I will absolutely assure you, it makes your blood thinner. Okay, we can see that under the microscope, but people who are sensitive to it will bleed more frequently because it makes your blood thinner. So you follow what I just said. So some people actually can't take it because their blood is too thin and it will enhance bleeding. Follow what I just said. So that happens in a few people, but it definitely happens. There's no doubt about it that that happens. So when you give it, you gotta, you know, let people know that if you start bruising, every time you bump yourself, you get bruises, your blood's too thin. You better take less or not take it. Okay, so that's something to really consider in the picture of that. So the two counterindications are if you're on medication or if your blood's too thin. Now, sometimes you're not going to know that. Oh, well, hey, I bleed easy. Well, then don't take it. But other people, they don't know that, and so they take it. And it's like, wow, you know, I'm bruising so easily. What's going on here? Then it's too much for them. You either cut it in half or take them off it. So those are considerations. But it's a lot safer than statins, which, you know, 9% of the people take statins get diabetes. It raises your blood sugar up to 40 points. 57% of the people with statins have hepatitis of some sort of problem, including, you know, dying from the statin effect on the liver. People get lots and lots of mental problems. People got lots of cramps and spasms, and it depletes your CoQ10. So there are a lot of problems, and I think I already mentioned it, but I'll mention again, the recent research by the, you know, confirming, Journal of Archives of Internal Medicine, the big AMA journal, 2009, make the headlines, there is no connection between cholesterol levels and heart disease. So a lot of people are taking it for no reason at all. If you're taking it to clean your arteries, this is a whole lot safer way to go. It's safer because it's a more authentic way to keep your blood thin and to clean your arteries and to have the anti-inflammatory and the anti-aging effects that it creates and the anti-scarring. Because what I found in diabetics, it cuts down the scarring as well. And we find that it opens up the inflammation in the pancreas, creates scarring so that the beta cells of the pancreas can't get the insulin out. And it kind of opens up the ducts. So that's very exciting, used in that way. So there, those are the kind of multiple levels of which this is useful. It is not a digestive enzyme. However, if you eat it with your food, it will digest your food. It's a very expensive way. You don't want to do that. It needs to be taken 1 hour before food, usually awake in bedtime and 1 hour during sometime during the day. 5 caps 3 times a day. Five capsules or 1 scoop twice a day, or 5 capsules twice a day is generally what works for people, awake in bedtime, practically speaking. They have a serious clotting problem. If they just had an operation, you don't give it before the operation, and you wait a day or two after the operation because it will create bleeding, which you don't want. Yeah. You have to wait, like starting a day or two before you don't take it. If you're flying on an airplane, the main cause of death on airplane is a clot. So if you take it while you fly, which is a very smart thing to do, it protects you against that. That's the main, as I say, the thrombophlebitis that you can get on flying, it's a common thing, relatively common, then forms a clot that can go to your lungs and can kill you. So taking it 5 caps 3 times a day for a few days while you're flying is generally a good idea.
Three times a day, not twice, three times a day.
Because you're under a high stress situation called flying in an airplane.
Good.
You take it for a few days. It works immediately. Now, the other downside is it works immediately. It works immediately. That's a problem. Because if you take it outside the capsule and you get it and you don't wash it down completely, you can get a laryngitis. It's going to start dissolving your tissues and your, you know, throat and there. So you got to get into your stomach pretty quickly. So you want to wash it down. Rinse it, you know, get it going. It doesn't dissolve. Get it going. Swallow it. And follow with the chaser.
Your favorite juice, Jason.
Yeah, little green juice. But my saying is, you don't want any left around in your mouth. If you're doing a capsule, it's not a problem. If you're doing a powder, it is a problem. And you really, really need to warn people because they can get really a burn in their mouth. Okay.
What about
that? You can get a little bit of that. Yeah, not in the stomach, because the stomach's use of acid, and you don't have a problem in the bowel. It's really your mouth.